some people got away all right. Well, they had busted through, clear down a plaque of mine. 6 feet of water in the streets of Evangeline. Away. They're trying to wash us away. Louisiana. Louisiana. They're trying to wash us away. They're trying to wash us away.
Hello. Welcome to Good Rockin' Tonight. 22nd of January? I think it is. We've got another guest from the Hall of Fame. Now, a lot of y'all, if you're in the Baton Rouge area, you've heard of his little brother. His little brother is Eddie Smith.
Correct.
And Eddie sings.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Before Eddie sang, Cookie sang.
Right.
With a group called the In Crowd.
Right. Some which, before that, yeah.
Yeah. They're the In Crowd's members of the Louisiana Music Hall of Fame. We're happy to have Cookie with us tonight. I've known Cookie since, I'm going to say 1966, maybe five.
Yeah,
for sure six.
66.
Yeah, he played my senior prom after party. What can you say?
Right.
There's a gig somewhere. Eddie has them all now. If it was,
yeah,
Eddie would be playing it.
That's right. I go listen to him every once in a while.
I do too.
Yeah.
I talked to him today. I said, I know you're playing. He said, yeah, man, I'm doing like 20 something days in a row. I said, how's your throat holding? I said, well, it's pretty good.
Yeah.
Okay, Rod.
Good.
Eddie runs here, Rod Stewart, sometimes with his throat. Bud explained to me a long time ago, that's the only way he can make money like he used to make.
Right.
Just playing that many days.
We used to play a lot of days too, and you get tired of it. You know, so many, but you need the money, and it helps a lot to play the music.
Cookie brought some old 45s from the day. This is a song called Baby, You're So Fine. It's a really good song, too.
Yeah.
This one is maybe the biggest of the In Crowd songs, Keep Your Hands Off My Baby.
Right. I was on TV one time, and my daughter was like two or three years old, and I brought her up on the stage, and I sang that song with Keep Your Hands Off My Baby. And I meant it.
And the flip side is a song my old roommate, Hal Ellis, wrote.
Yeah. What is that one?
Go Away.
Go Away. Yeah, he wrote that one.
And Hal was a good guy. This one is Baby, You're So Fine. And in a minute, we're going to treat you to a rendition of Someday After a While.
With just the guitar.
And with just the guitar.
Sounds a lot better with all the music.
Which is perfectly appropriate for the keyboard player from the In Crowd.
Who is the keyboard player?
Oh.
It wasn't me. I just sang. Long time ago, I used to play the piano.
Every
the
once in a while, you would.
Different things.
Of course, so did Billy Powell. Billy Powell didn't sing, but. Third try. But anyway, Cookie. Now, we'll go through the strange questions a little weird. Where are you from?
I'm from Baton Rouge.
Okay. Mm-hmm. We'll leave it at that.
That's where I'm from. I was born in Baton Rouge. A lady at the Lake Hospital, 1942.
Ooh.
Is that 1942? Yeah, 43. My brother was born in 1942. I was born on his birthday.
One year?
He was 1 year old, one year apart. Ain't that something?
Well, we're both North Baton Rouge guys.
Yeah.
In our day. We can't ever live that down, no matter what we do.
That's right.
It's fine with me. All the schools I went to died.
Yeah.
And left. I went to Dalton. Nah. Prescott. Gone. Estruma. Bad joke. It's back, but
yeah,
not really.
Well, the one I went to is Glen Oaks.
Yeah.
It's still there.
Well, people used to accuse us of being north of Choctaw. That was a bad thing. We used to get on Glen Oaks and say, they're north of Airline.
Right.
That's almost another whole parish.
Yeah.
But not. Did you start off in the Catholic circuit? The CYOs and,
well,
God forbid, Redemptorist.
When I first started off, I was like 15 years old, and Daddy would bring me to different places, and I'd just go in where a band was and sing a couple songs, you know, and they'd say, hey, you're good. You know, when I was 15 years old, how good was you? But
anyhow. Yeah, cookie, you were.
But anyhow, yeah, and I worked up and, you know, started playing in different places at schools and different things like that, yeah. And then we started playing at places like you would call us up and we'd go play it. And then S.J. Montabana, he was our manager.
My partner.
Is he? Yeah.
In fact, we go back to a common gig.
Mm-hmm.
The only open air gig in Baton Rouge. Magella Field at Redemptorist.
Right. Opened up for...
You opened up and Debbie and the Lads opened up, the two local bands.
Okay, I don't remember them playing. They must have been before us.
They were first.
Okay, and then we had the Who. We had...
We had the Blues Magoos. No.
Blues Magoos.
Yeah.
They were the... Yeah. But the biggest band was...
Peter.
Hmm?
Peter. Herman.
Oh yeah, Herman the Hermits. I can't remember nothing anymore, but Herman the Hermits was the band that was there that pulled all the people in, and the other bands were just starting off, really, you know.
Yeah, was from Los Angeles,
mm-hmm.
Peter was from England, and about 2 weeks before the show, I got a call, and the booking agent in New York wanted to give me another band.
Really?
And I said, how much? He said, I'm giving them to you.
Yeah.
We're bringing another group in, and we're going to do a full tour on them, and we're tying it in and opening with this tour, and I don't have any venues in the South that want to book them right now. And I said, who is it? He said, correct. I said, the Who? He said, yeah, they got 11 records in England. Okay, you familiar? Yeah, I'm familiar. He said, they're going to be much bigger than Herman's Hermits before it's over with.
Yeah. But you know, one thing about it, you know, the Who was known for throwing their guitar down and breaking it, right? Well, you know what I'm going to tell you.
Yeah, I know. I heard the story from Eli.
Our guitar player broke his guitar.
Hal Ellis, my roommate.
Hal Ellis. And actually, it was an accident.
Yeah.
He didn't mean to throw it down.
He was throwing it to Daryl, wasn't he?
But they got mad at him for that. They thought we were
trying to upstage
him. Yeah. So anyhow.
Hal would no more break that guitar for anything. That was his blessed Mose right.
Mm-hmm.
He loved that axe. And he was heartbroken. Because he threw it to Daryl and Daryl dropped it.
Yeah.
And Pete Townsend came in the dressing room, didn't he?
He may have, I don't remember.
I think he did and jumped out.
Yeah, he was mad. I know he was really mad.
Trying to upstage my act.
Right.
You don't let him do that. Just chewed him out in British.
But that's life.
Yeah.
Yeah. We thought it was funny.
Except for Daryl. Daryl wasn't happy.
Yeah.
And then Townsend came back later and explained to him. He said, you don't bloody break good guitars. You break cheap ones that you buy for nothing. We keep the parts. Here, open the trunk. And they had a trunk full of heads. And
yeah. I always figured that somebody would give them to break their guitar. You know, that's the way I figured it worked. People would give them guitars to break.
Just buying $10 guitars.
Really? Mm-hmm. Well, back then, $10 was a lot of money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But for them.
For us, too.
Yeah, but a Mose Rider or Les Paul, it wasn't.
It's worth more than that.
It was probably, as said, it was Kenny. You, yeah.
What?
But that was a fun gig.
Oh, yeah.
And I started like, what was your first gig?
What was our first gig? With the In Crowd? Mm-hmm.
Just professionally.
Man, you're talking about 50 years ago.
I know. I'm in the same boat.
Well, you know, I played with three or four other bands before the In Crowd, and we all was pretty good making average money. But you know, when we got the In Crowd and we started getting bigger, we started making a lot of money. It was completely different than when we you know, played at first. But when you get well known, you make a lot more money than you do when you ain't well known.
Well, unless you get lucky.
Get lucky? That's what it takes a lot of, too.
My first two gigs I ever played, I made some decent money. One was a Pack-A-Sack grand opening.
Oh, man.
And that was on, I want to say it was an airline highway.
Airline highway.
North.
Yeah, Pack-A-Sack was a popular place back then.
Yeah, it was. And the second one was Funfair Park.
We used to play on Sundays at Funfair Park.
We played the opening weekend at Funfair Park one summer. So, got lucky, made a little bit of bucks, more than 10 bucks, you know.
Yeah, that was a popular place back then, man.
They both were. Dumb booking kid bands, but that's okay. I didn't need that in my ear. Just thought about it. Yeah, it was a strange, strange place. And the night y'all played, our senior prom after party was across from Victoria Drive. It was a, what was that? It was a camp somebody used for parties, and we booked it for the after party.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That worked out good.
It what? Wasn't that good?
It worked out good.
Oh, yeah, it worked out good. I was going to say, wouldn't it?
Y'all played in Bonnie MC'd.
Mm-hmm.
The old Pied Piper.
The old Pied Piper, yeah.
That's what we ought to do. We ought to have Ginger and Darlene and a couple of them on the show.
Yeah, that'd be good.
We had them at Mossy Go-Go enough. That's where I broke into promoting.
Mm-hmm.
Before Estee and I ever partnered up, I did the McCoys. I did the Music Machine and a big song, Talk Talk.
Call what?
Talk Talk.
Talk Talk. I don't know if I remember Talk Talk.
You remember, don't you, Morty?
You don't even remember Talk Talk.
Yeah. And the thing that caught Sam's attention was I put on a show at the hall. And he was freaked out because I had 4,000 people at Independence Hall for the Animals.
For the Animals, yeah. That was a good group, though.
They were big.
They was.
They were big, and Eric Burden was every 10 minutes blue volumes.
Really?
And chasing it down with Jack. How we got up, I don't know.
What was that first big hit? The one you just said.
In New Orleans was the original title.
Yeah.
There is a house in New Orleans. Yeah, they call the Rising Sun.
New Orleans. I remember that song, it gets really high after a while. I can sing the bottom part there.
Not for Eric, it
didn't. Not for him. He could, boy, he could hit it. So I didn't ever sing that song.
I had one I recorded on a Christmas album with Jimmy Davis. And it was called It's Christmas Time Again. Mm-hmm. And it was to Danny Boy. Do you know how high Danny Boy gets?
Come me back, yeah. I could sing that song.
And Jimmy Davis nailed it.
Yeah. Oh, when it gets high, when it goes, I'll be here. And
yep, that's exactly it. Yeah. He could sing it. Who would think the governor could sing that? But he could.
Yep.
And I don't think y'all ever played for us at Independence Hall, did you?
Who, me?
The in crowd.
No, I don't think so.
Because y'all were theoretically a Montel group.
Right. He kept us pretty busy.
When John Madison was on one show, and of course, he had Everybody's Pillow, which is also Montel.
Mm-hmm.
And I used them to open Creedence and maybe Can't Eat, a couple of shows.
Mm-hmm.
Sam said, it is a band on there. Yeah, Sam, you got it. And it worked. Tell us some of the fun things you had in music.
In music?
Yeah.
Fun things?
Fun things. Thunderbird Beach.
Oh, yeah. Thunderbird Beach was a fun thing. But it's been so long, I really don't remember a whole lot of places that I even played. I can't even remember my name sometimes.
It's like they say in New Orleans, ain't there no more.
Yeah, we used to go to New Orleans, and I remember one time, we only had like a 4 or 5 piece band. Mm-hmm. Well, we go in this big nightclub, and you have to have, they have rules in New Orleans, you have to have, I think, 10 musicians. So we happened to have a couple setup guys, and one of their friends followed them.
And Daryl plays tambourine.
And we got all those together, and we had a 10-piece band, but only 4 or 5 of us could really play. They would just get up there and, you know, make a little noise. Yep, that was one of the big things.
I remember one night I did some filming, 35 millimeter with y'all,
mm-hmm.
at the Colonel's Club.
Colonel's Club.
On the stage that high in the back corner.
Yeah. Man, you remember the Colonel's Club? God.
Sort of.
Yeah.
Sort of. I remember the lights were bouncing purple off the mic stands.
Yeah. And the little guy that was the head guy used to holler like crazy, especially when we'd take a break. If you had a 15-minute break, but at 15 minutes, he was hollering.
Well, it's like the carousel.
Yeah.
Big Sylvia would come in and yell, post time!
Yeah, post time. That was his favorite words.
Yep. But it worked.
Oh, yeah.
It always worked. In just a minute, I think. Cookie, we can take a break, and when we come back from the break,
I'll do it. Okay.
Okay. Marty?
Wish I was new to this town. Just pulling in and checking in.
From the airport.
Oh, honey, just take mom's car. She just had navigation installed.
I totally got this. We were just there.
Hey, isn't that?
Yep. Program the airport in, just in case.
You don't need a new car to have new technology. Mike's Audio, conveniently located on Airline Highway near the corner of Bluebonnet.
Judy in the sky. Well, that's what you are. A lemonade pie with your brand new car.
My horse says,
what you say?
Without me, no, you're dying. Baby, baby,
So until then, this is John Fred saying, keep it rocking and good night.
There is a house in New Orleans. They call the Rising Sun.
They lit the midnight vigil, shine a light on me. Let the midnight vigil shine a heaven-loving light on me.
As a little girl, her name is Sing. She liked to play with my ding-a-ling. My ding-a-ling is the cutest thing. When Sing plays with my ding-a-ling.
Heaven, please send to all mankind understanding and peace in mind. But if it's not asking too much, please send me someone to love.
Well, I heard the news.
See you later, alligator. After a while, crocodile.
What lightning.
Well, the G-Man, T-Man, revenue is too. Searching for a place where he made his brew.
I'm a honky-tonk man. And I can't seem to stop.
Goodness gracious, great balls of fire.
I let it love what I thought it was funny.
Womp, bomb, loom, bomb, lomp, bomb, bomb, tootie, boot, oh, rude. Tootie, boot, oh, rude.
You gotta jump and jive and then you really gotta jump and jive and then you really gotta jump and jive and then you really gotta jump and jive and
oh, Susie Q, I love you, my Susie.
One night with you is what I'm now praying for.
They call me the Batman.
Hi folks, Clarence Bugs here. Coach Roger Cador would take the time to tell you how to catch our brand new show, The Roger Cador Show, but as you can see, he's kind of busy right now out at Scoreboards. Baton Rouge's newest sports grill with food that is absolutely amazing. Catch the show 8 o'clock Tuesday nights, 6:30 p.m. on Wednesdays, and on Pelican Television's YouTube channel as well. You want to come out and have a great time. It's awesome, isn't it, Coach?
Mm-hmm.
Told you.
No one can stop me when I taste the feeling. Nothing could ever bring me down. Nothing could ever bring me down. Taste the feeling.
Strangely enough, Cookie Smith is going to become the first artist in the Hall of Fame ever to perform a song on Good Rockin' Tonight, the TV show.
Wonderful.
So, Cookie, knock yourself out, bro.
All right. I've got to ride that lonesome train. My heart is heavy from aching pain. But I'd say someday, someday, baby, after a while, you'll be sorry. Trouble's trouble on my mind. But I don't need your sympathy. So baby, baby, don't you pity me. I may be blue, but I don't mind. I've got to leave those cares behind. Did I I say someday, someday, baby, after a while, you'll be sorry.
Folks, that was a great premiere of singing on the show. You still sing pretty good, Cookie.
Well, I appreciate it.
That was the song called Someday After a While that Cookie and the In Crowd recorded in 65. And it was written by John Mayall, who's...
He sang it, too.
Yeah. You don't get a better singer, better writer.
You talking about me?
No.
Oh, okay.
No. Wait, who did it on the record? Hal did it, huh?
Hal did what?
Did the song on the record or you did it? I'm trying to remember.
You talking about singing it?
Yeah.
Wah!
Okay. I heard Hal singing a million times.
Well,
in the living room.
Yeah. Well, that's where he sang it at. In the living room.
And the commercials you probably saw, we hustled a new product on there. It's called Good Rockin' Tonight. Sort of like that. And it's the true story or true history of rock and roll dash Louisiana.
Mm-hmm.
This is 31 songs by 30 artists, all from Louisiana.
I'm not on there.
You're not on there.
God.
But it started, and they wrote these songs too, and sang them. It started with a 1918 song written by Leadbelly.
I could have been on that, 1918.
It's an amazing collection. It's like a history lesson. If you care to listen to some, it's like taking a history lesson by CD. Because it's all real. And this stuff I left out. We have Good Rockin' Tonight, which is 1947.
Yeah.
By Roy Brown. Cosmo recorded that. But 2 weeks after Cosmo recorded Good Rockin' Tonight, he recorded another later hit song. The second song he recorded in, I think it was March of 47, was a song called Since I Fell For You by a black swing band leader and his black chick singer.
What was that second word there?
Paul Gayden.
Okay.
And Annie Laurie. It took 13 years for Lenny Welch to record that. So Cosmo had a pretty good month.
Mm-hmm.
Just about every month he had a pretty good month.
Yep.
Okay, where were we?
Well, I just finished singing a song, and that's where we was at.
Okay, we were talking about fun gigs. Thunderbird Beach was one.
Yeah, Thunderbird
Beach. Did you ever play across the river at Bayou Corn?
We never played a whole bunch across the river at the ballrooms.
I was thinking the other water park was across the river, Camp Bayou Corn.
Yeah, we played over there a few times.
Because Bonnie did a bunch of shows over there.
Who?
Bonnie Fusel
did it.
Mm-hmm. With Swingsville?
Yeah. I remember Bonnie. Yep, I do. But anyhow, we played a lot of different places. It seemed like we played more like the younger in the Greek fountains. You remember them? They kind of played. Yeah. They kind of played for their older guys, you know, like 20, 21.
Yeah, the frats.
We played
the frats.
Yeah, they played for the frats, and we kind of played all the other little places with young people.
Y'all had more fun than they did.
Yeah, we played a lot of, we played a whole bunch for young people. And we enjoyed that, because they couldn't tell when we messed up too much, you know.
It's not like they were aficionados of the music.
Right. They didn't care about the music. They wanted to dance, you know.
And drink. Just saying, they might have wanted to drink, too.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you had a couple of guys in the first group Now, where'd you get Sammy from?
Well, Sammy, what happened was...
That's why the Greek fountains picked up Danny.
Oh, really? Well, let me tell you.
You had Sammy Cohen, they had Sammy Rubin, they had Danny Cohen.
Mm-hmm. Well, what happened was, me and Hal was playing in a kind of a rock and roll band, and we had Billy come along and
Lester.
Yeah, they came along, they was getting up a band to play the Beatles, I call it the Beatles music, you know. And so they come over and asked us to join their group. And that's what we've done. We quit playing in the little band we was in, and we went over with Reuben and Billy, and we started the In Crowd. That's how we got started.
I remember when we inducted the In Crowd, Sammy had a lot of pictures from the day.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of pictures.
Yeah, he did.
Gerald had a decent many. Decent, yeah. And of course, Hal was going, and Lester was going.
Hal was really a talented boy. He could play the guitar. He was outstanding.
Well, I used to say Robert Hubbard was a dear friend of mine.
Mm-hmm.
Still is.
Mm-hmm.
And I would go over to Robert's house off of Perkins Road, and Robert would sit upstairs in his room stretching strings to Gabor Szabo and Wes Montgomery and jazz.
Mm-hmm.
And Hal, when he moved in with me, Hal wasn't stretching strings to anything but Albert and B.B. King. And he could stretch them strings.
He could stretch. Yeah, you know, back before the Beatles and stuff, we didn't seem like we stretched the string very much. But once they got going and you know, their songs and the music was a lot different than the old rock and roll, because like I said, hey, you could play four or five chords of the old rock and roll, buddy, you could sing some songs.
And George was doing a lot of innovative things with the guitar, too.
Uh-huh. So once the Beatles and stuff come out, we started adding stuff to it. And, you know, it was fewer musicians in the band, but we played louder, and you could hear it really good.
Well, the band was good for years.
Yeah. Yeah, we had a great time playing together. Enjoyed it.
In fact, you and Eddie in the group played my 50th reunion from Struma.
At where? Struma?
At Drusilla. You remember that?
No.
you sang with Eddie and Butch.
Mm-hmm.
It was really good, because you were doing the original songs, and so was Eddie, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Recreated a whole lot of what our prom was. I'm an oldie guy.
And me.
Sounded good. It was a lot of fun. Looking at the clock over there.
Hey, I see you.
I don't know. We do too? I think we are. That's why I looked at the clock. Hey,
all right.
You want to take us into time out?
Do I want to take this time out?
You want to take us into it?
Yeah, we're going to take a little break here, drink a little water, you know, loosen our throat up a little bit. Well, thank you so much.
We'll be right back after these messages.
Prison bands, that label getting away. The band's jumping down the jump again to swing. You should have heard.
Beauty in the sky, well that's what you are. A lemonade pie with your brand new car. It's a cantaloupe pie, come to me tonight. With Beauty in the sky, we can't say. Situation.
So until then, this is John Fred saying, keep it rocking and good night.
See you later, alligator. After 1 o'clock at all.
White lightning.
Well, the G-Man, T-Man, revenue is too. Searching for a place where he made his brew.
I'm a honky-tonk man, and I can't seem to stop.
Goodness gracious, great balls of fire.
I let it love what I thought it was money.
Womp, bomb, loom, bomb, lomp, bomb, bomb, tootie-boot, oh, hoo.
Then you really gotta jump jiving.
Oh, Susie Q, I love you, my Susie Q.
One night with you is what I'm now praying for.
They call me the bad man.
There is a house in New Orleans. They call the rising sun.
They lit the midnight vigil, shine a light on me. Let the midnight vigil shine a heaven loving light on me.
There's a little girl, her name is Sing. She like to play with my ding-a-ling. My ding-a-ling is the cutest thing. When Sing plays with my ding-a-ling.
Heaven please send to all mankind understanding and peace in mind. But if it's not asking too much, please send me someone to love.
Well, I heard the news.
No one can stop me when I taste the feeling. Nothing could ever bring me down. Nothing could ever bring me down. Taste the feeling.
Hi folks, Clarence Bugs here. Coach Roger Cador would take the time to tell you how to catch our brand new show, The Roger Cador Show, but as you can see, he's kind of busy right now out at Scoreboards, Baton Rouge's newest sports grill with food that is absolutely amazing. Catch the show, 8 o'clock Tuesday nights, 6:30 p.m. on Wednesdays, and on Pelican Television's YouTube channel as well. You want to come out and have a great time? It's awesome, isn't it, Coach?
Mm-hmm.
Told you.
Look, your dad gave me his baby to go pick up your brother from the airport.
Oh, honey, just take mom's car. She just had navigation installed.
I totally got this. We were just there.
Hey, isn't that...
Yep. I programmed the airport in, just in case.
You don't need a new car to have new technology. Mike's Audio, conveniently located on Airline Highway near the corner of Bluebonnet.
Locked out jailbird, sing that rock. Everybody let rock. Everybody in a old sailboat was dancing to the jailhouse rock. Spider Murphy played it in the
sack. That's right, we're going to have good rocking tonight with the Jailhouse Rock.
We're back, huh?
We're back.
All right.
You happy to be back?
I'm happy. Happy, happy, happy.
Strange. I like it. New attitude.
New attitude, brother. I'm happy all the time. I'm a happy guy.
If we get you and Cookie both on the same time, we could have some.
Cookie Boo, who that?
Eddie.
Oh, is that what you call him?
No, Eddie.
Okay.
I always listen to Eddie and think of Cookie.
Yeah, well, he learned a lot from me. I remember the first time he ever played in the band, it was me got him in the band, he played with us. Our drummer couldn't make it, so we needed a drummer. We're playing in End of the World. You ever heard End of the World?
Yeah.
Bayou Pigeon. And we needed a guitar, I mean a drummer, and I thought of my brother, he was learning how to play. So I got him to come over there and he played. the drum with us. That's the first time he ever played in the band. So he don't give me no...
I remember when Eddie was with the Popsicle.
Popsicle, sure.
Eddie sang sort of like you. It's not like now, his voice has gone Rod Stewart from singing too much.
Mm-hmm. But you got to realize, me and him are brothers. He's 9 years younger than me.
Mm-hmm.
But he used to come and listen to us play, you know, when he was young. And so he probably heard me singing so much at the house. He learned a little bit from him right there, I guess. I don't know.
Well, he definitely took after you for a while.
Yeah. He should have stayed. Well, I'm just joking. My brother, me and him, good friends.
No, Eddie's making books. When nobody else is making books, Eddie and Robert.
Yeah, but you know his piano player's been real sick. And I hadn't heard.
I haven't heard from him since he got out of the hospital. I don't think anybody has.
Yeah, man, you talk about a piano player now. That man played the piano in the. What else did he play? He played two things at once.
He's playing the bass one hand.
Yeah, bass. He plays the bass. Man, I tell you, Eddie can get by with just three pieces where everybody else has to have at least four. He's a talented boy. He's a guitar player. He's a guitar player, very good too.
But now he's got Peggy, and Peggy can really play the keyboards.
Okay, I hadn't.
Peggy Polk?
Yeah, I don't think I've heard her.
She can definitely play the keyboards.
But she can't play two things at once.
I'm not sure she can. I don't think she wants to.
I don't. It's easy to play one.
They got Joey Decker now on bass.
Yeah, he had to add a piece.
And Joey's real good.
Yeah.
I got Joey his gig with LaRue to replace Leon.
Mm.
And Bill Evans and I drove to Lafayette right after I put him with LaRue.
Mm-hmm.
And you know Bill Evans from Student in the Country. And Bill said, Michael, he plays like Leon used to play, better than Leon now. And he really does. He emulated Leon as a young man.
Yeah. You know, back then when I used to play that stuff, we didn't do all the things these guys do. You know, a bass guitar player, boom, 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 that's what we done. And now these bass guitar players take lead. I mean, they've changed and improved a lot.
I'll tell you who I put in the Hall of Fame. Joe Osborne.
I don't know if I know him. If I see him, I know him. Maybe.
Joe Osborne's from Shreveport.
Mm-hmm.
And he got his first gig when James Burton called him from L.A., was playing with Johnny Rivers.
Mm-hmm.
And he told him to go to his office and pick up a check and to get a bus ticket, ride the bus to L.A., first to go by and pick up a Fender Precision bass at a music store. He said, do what I tell you, and learn it on the way out here. Because he was a guitar player, like James.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, well, when did I start playing? The day you get here. Who am I playing with? Ricky Nelson. Okay. And Joe, when he passed a couple of months ago, he had between 600 and 700 gold records in his garage and his rooms and on his walls. Everything from Rocky Horror Picture Show, Bridge Over Troubled Water, all the Fifth Dimension stuff. Aquarius is one of them.
Yeah.
All the Richard Harris stuff, MacArthur Park. All that stuff. He recorded more great hit records as a bass player than anybody ever did.
Mm.
He did country, he did rock and roll.
Yeah.
He's the guy, Carpenters. You ever remember hearing the pit bass?
Oh yeah.
That's Joe Osborne.
I remember him.
And then when I presented him his plaque and his award, the record I put on his gold record was a song he recorded in the garage studio, which was his studio in L.A. It was starting to be a couple, but he didn't like the boy. He said he was arrogant. He didn't care for him. His sister, yes. was Karen Carpenter's first single. Not mad.
Man, good.
Needless to say, they did all the Carpenter stuff, and he became famous for that pick. Well, like the boxer. Na da da. Joe Osmond. Just things you would never think of. Sweet Caroline was one of Joe's bass songs.
Really?
He did that whole Memphis session with Neil. People that come from Louisiana have got the talent. They've always had the talent. Yeah. And I could go on a speech about the state of Louisiana, not paying attention. I will for a second. The state of Louisiana doesn't pay attention to their music and their musicians. For years they've had a thing about saying, there's only 3,000 musicians in the state. No. No. I don't know what parish they're counting. It must be a rural, small rural parish. Because there's a hell of a lot more than 3,000 musicians.
Oh, yeah.
And one particular Secretary of State, we won't name him, Jay Darden, told me that was to keep the musicians from getting voting power. If they put the true number of musicians in the state, that's a voting block. That's a lot of musicians. Because, you know, you go to churches, there's 15 and 20 musicians in every church.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Every place.
You know, it's amazing. You'll go in a church, and like you said, there's so many musicians. I mean, people get up there and sing, and say, I didn't realize how many you have of talented people. I mean,
it's like a talent showcase.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they got some talented people in Baton Rouge.
And the churches with great music.
Oh, yeah. That's mostly what I sing now. I sing to the Young at Heart over at Bethany.
Eddie sings at church, too.
Huh?
Eddie sings at church, too, doesn't he?
He used to. I don't think he sings anymore.
Huh. I knew he did.
Yeah, he did, but I don't think he sings anymore. The guy that was the preacher, I don't think he preaches there anymore, and him and Eddie were good friends. I don't think Eddie sings there anymore.
One guy I'm thinking about bringing in very soon, getting new one in Baton Rouge, he's playing with Lucas Spinoza's band, which is now called Rugon.
Rugon?
Yeah, with Brian Romano, which is Buddy's kid, is playing with. And the other guitar player that's with the band, we have Brian on guitar and sax, and we have Bob Henderson.
Bob Henderson.
On the other guitar and the other sax.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I know Bob.
Bob is a killer.
Eddie used to date his sister.
Tareva?
You know who I'm not.
Well, Tareva's as good as Bob.
Oh, yeah. She's talented, that girl.
Pick an instrument. They can play them. Anything. And sing.
But you know, the brothers you're just talking about, Spinoza's?
Lucas.
Lucas, is that the oldest one?
Johnny's oldest.
Johnny, you know.
The drummer.
We got him in our band. He had never played, I don't think, in a band. We got him, it was his first band he played with us. I don't think that was the In Crowd, that was before the In Crowd with our other band.
Because the In Crowd name mutated. I was part of that, unfortunately, at the Belmont. The In Crowd had become Johnny Spinoza.
Right.
Then he traded with Ted Baco.
Was that when they were playing at the
Magnolia Room?
Yeah. Yeah, I remember they had called themselves the In Crowd. But I think that's after we had broken up.
Yeah.
When he started.
Well, and we had Jimmy Cheek on one guitar.
Jimmy Cheek.
Freddie Wall on another.
Yeah, I don't know if I know him, but anyhow.
He went to a strummer. Les Wallace was on another guitar.
I had Les
Crazy Leiden.
Les Wallace was in one of our bands too before the In Crowd.
Really?
Sure did. He played guitar, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sure did.
He looked the part. He looked like a rock guitar player.
He did.
And every once in a while, he played like one.
Yeah. Yeah.
I ran across Les about 2 months ago. A guy from Springfield, Missouri called me up and said, Mr. Shepherd, my name's Nelson whatever. And he said, I got a guy that's been teaching guitar to my son. He lives about 40 miles south of me. I said, Arkansas? Yeah. Okay, because Springfield's down at the bottom left corner of Missouri. He said, yeah, and he's written like 200 songs, and they're not on paper. He's got them all on his head. And he can pick a guitar. I said, who are we talking about? He said, Les Wallace. Crazy Leiden. Yes, he can. And he probably did write 200 songs. Yeah. If he remembers them, it's a miracle if somebody remembers them.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have thought Les would remember them. But,
yeah, amazing, ain't it? How many people you run into and meet on the way and played with so many different people?
Well, we're still here.
Huh?
We're still here.
Yeah.
Some of them are. We're still here.
Yeah, well, look, Hal ain't here no more. A drummer, he ain't here anymore. We've lost.
Well, it's like the roommates I had. John Fritt was one roommate, Hal was another, and Charlie Spinoza was the other.
Well, you ever think he might be bad luck?
I might be, because Fritz did. Hal shot himself.
Yeah.
And so did Charlie.
Man.
And those were two talented guys, not to count Fred. He's pretty talented, too.
Yeah, you were around some talented guys. Hey, look. Hey, bro. Hey. I said, talented guys.
And you weren't looking, so.
I need to laugh there.
You're
okay?
Out. I was busy.
Uh-huh. Following his talents.
What do you have?
Any stories you want to tell me of the music business from the old days? Any recording stories or?
Well, not really. I mean,
best gig anyplace?
Best gig. We had so many good gigs. I tell you what, though, we opened up one time. We went to New Orleans, and they was having all these big, big stars. And we opened up, and I think John Fred was after us. But we had like 10,000 people at that place. And this was when we were first getting started. But they had. I mean, I can't think of the guys, but I think all of them was from England. A lot of the England stars. And that was a big thing. I really enjoyed that. I got to meet a couple of the guys, not many of them, because they all would leave, you know. But the one I got to meet was, he was from the United States, and he put that song out. See the tree, how big it's grown.
Bobby.
I met him. We were sitting in the, big trailer.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a very, very nice guy. I sat out and talked to him for a long time.
I had him here at the first Optimus Spring Fair.
Mm-hmm.
That was out where Cortana is, except mm-hmm. facing Florida, by the boot store. And I was listening to him, and he had strings. He was really good.
He played lead guitar for, I can't think of the name of the guy now, but he played lead guitar for, the guy looks like he's half blind when he sings. But anyhow, I can't think of his name, but he played.
Millsap?
Hmm?
Ronnie Millsap?
No, he's blind. This guy wasn't really blind.
Clarence Carter.
I don't remember his name, but anyhow, he played lead guitar. You know, but I never seen him play lead guitar because I thought he was just a singer.
Yeah.
But he was a really good lead guitar player. Cause the band he played in was great.
Back when I was doing fairs, well, on lead guitar, we'd book Roy Clark. That's a lead guitar.
Mm-hmm.
KB's out. Yeah, that just brought up a whole strange path in my mind. And
yeah.
The Spring Fair opened it that year with Dobie Gray.
Toby Gray?
Dobie.
Or Joby.
Dobie.
Yeah.
Give Me the Beat Boys and Free My Soul.
Mm-hmm.
Drift Away. And Bobby Goldsboro. And Paul Williams.
Paul Williams. Shorter than me?
Yeah.
Hey.
He's almost a dwarf.
2 minutes. Yeah. All right.
There's two of them over there.
Man, time goes by fast when you're enjoying what you're doing, you know it? I wish this time would go by fast. Hey, I like to joke a lot, everybody. That's one thing I still can do is joke. And I can sing. I hadn't lost my voice. I can't remember anything, but other than I'm doing good.
Who can? Anybody remember anything? Yeah. What? Huh? We're going to go in close up. I'm going to remind everybody to go on the website, lmhof.org, and check out Good Rockin' Tonight on the website. There's some amazing, amazing guys on this record. And, of course, we have, you probably heard on the thing, we have a John Fred 29 track album, which is all the way back to his Stroll, Baby Know You Made Me Cry, and Shirley, Mirror, Mirror, all the way up through the Paula days.
You know, he was a good songwriter. He wrote some good songs.
With Andrew.
With Andrew. Yeah, like I say, Andrew, right? He's a talented guy. He's been playing for a while. He's still rolling.
Andrew brought a whole new dimension to it. Okay, I'll give a speech. Alan, thank you for the trailer. Thank you for your work in there. Marty, thank you, I think. Guys, we're going to wrap it up for tonight. I will see you next Tuesday, 7 o'clock on the air. Bye.
Some people got away all right. Well, they have busted through, lay down a plaque of mine. 6 feet of water in the streets of Evangeline, Louisiana, Louisiana. They're trying to wash us away. They're trying to wash us away. Time to wash us away.